People have been fighting for 400 years.
Man. Your people's too.
So I just want you to explain what you mean by that.
I don't have to explain what's understood, man. You know what I mean by that. You know what I said by that. I ain't got to go farther. And if anybody don't understand that, then God be with them. Go look up the history. Go look up the history. Shit, don't everybody believe in Google? Go Google that shit. See what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about, man. You know what? I dare you to sit up there and say, explain. You know what I'm talking about, man. He's fighting people. You know we've been fighting 400 and still fighting to this day. To this day. To this day. You just sit here and you don't know what I'm talking about?
Welcome, welcome, welcome to our new listeners and to our regular listeners. Welcome to Specificity. Spell it S.P.E.C.I.F.I.C.I.T.Y, where we ask specific questions about specific topics, getting specific answers. The meaning of specificity is the state of being clearly defined or identified, to be precise, exact, or distinguished. All right, and joining me today is Dr. Paigton Mayes, and I say that with a smile. I'm a community health psychologist. Her education includes a Ph.D. in community psychology and a master's in public health. She is also the owner of AmonBooks. Now, we spoke a little about today's topic, the culture of physical health in the Black community. Before we get started, tell me one good thing, one positive thing going on.
In general or like in my field?
Let's do both.
In my field, I feel like there's a focus on, realizing the impact of race and discrimination on health. And so there's a push to focus on like health equity and making sure that not only are you getting access to the care that you need, but that it's equitable access. And that is access that's tailored to you as an individual rather than you as a disease or you as the race that you belong to, you know? Mm-hmm. So I think that's a positive in the field. In general, I think just continued like conversations about things that make people uncomfortable. I think that's always a positive thing.
Okay, keeping the same energy on the reverse. What's one negative thing, one bad thing?
Negative thing in my field would be that the field is mostly white.
Yeah.
And that can be a positive in that, you know, there are allies that exist who are also pushing forth, you know, health equity and things like that. But at the same time, it's difficult as a person of color being in a field where you're trying to educate white people on health equity and being just equitable across the board. So that can be difficult. In general, I think on the flip side of having more conversations, you also get ignorance. So that can be difficult to handle and navigate.
And then you use the word equity, equitable. What exactly does that mean? What does that involve?
I think it can be like an amalgamation of things. I think that equity, depending on what you're talking about, looks different. specifically with healthcare, it's not only ensuring, well, what it should be at least, is not only ensuring that people have access to healthcare, but it's ensuring that people also have access to other resources outside of healthcare, because everything is connected. And I think that's a big thing, is that, you know, my economic status, like how much money I make, is connected to the types of services and care that I can receive, you know? And so realizing that in healthcare settings can cause care to be more equitable. You know, like realizing if I'm a physician or if I'm a public health person and I'm dealing with someone, realizing that, you know, hey, they might not have the means to travel to X place to get X service. And so looking for other options, or making sure that you're giving them all the resources. So maybe there's a transportation service that they have access to, but they don't know about. I think that all ties into making care equitable. Did I answer your question?
Mm-hmm. Now, they say, Dr. Mayes, I have questions. Where are they able to follow you? How do they connect with you? Where can they find you?
If you have questions specific to public health, you can, probably the best way to do that is email. and my email is Paigton, so Paigton.Mayes@wichita.edu. That's probably the best way, because my other social media accounts are personal social media accounts, so that might not be the best way.
I got it. Now, your career path, it isn't common. It isn't necessarily the norm.
Yeah.
And, you know, from the outside looking in, it seems very overwhelming. You know, being a doctor, being in that field, what does it mean to you?
It means a lot, because of where I came from. It means that much more. So I come from a low income background. I was the first to go to college, like just bachelor's degree, the first to get, you know, the first in kind of everything, master's, PhD, and then a master's in public health. And so for me, it's more than just a degree, and I think that's what made it like less of a struggle, is remembering like you've come a very long way. You know, but I also think like teachers and stuff that I had back then, because I wouldn't have known anything about applying to college. I didn't know anything about applying to college or anything about the field that I went into until my high school year. So definitely owe it to teachers and stuff. And it is very stressful. I think that's something that people don't talk about often, is like pursuing higher education is very, very stressful. It's probably the most stressful thing I've ever done and will ever do in my life. It caused a lot of anxiety, depression, trying to be perfect and like fit this mold and, you know, get good grades and do all the things that everyone wants you to do, especially in a position like mine, where you're the only person in your family to do that. It's a lot of pressure. So it can be pretty difficult.
You use some key words that I hear a lot, especially on commercials or within my field of being a teacher. And I feel like they're assigned lackadaisically or without intention, the proper intention. What is the definition, given your background, of depression? What does that mean?
For me, I feel like the definition of depression is more so like just not having the motivation to do things. And I mean, when you're in school, I mean, you gotta have some level of motivation to, you know, keep up with assignments and keep up with different things that you have to do. So for me, yeah, it's definitely a lack of motivation to continue doing the things that you do, whether that's like small things, big things.
And the same question when it comes to anxiety.
Anxiety to me would be similar. Like, I think that depression and anxiety, in my case, it was kind of intermingled. But anxiety is more so just those worrisome thoughts that are always there consistently. And I feel like a lot of people who go towards like professional degrees probably have some level of like generalized anxiety, because it's a lot to be juggling at one point, and then you're always worried about, okay, what assignment do I have coming up? What do I have to teach to students if you're teaching, or how am I going to get my next meal? Because a lot of us were poor, like below poverty rates. So
my wife and I actually had an interesting conversation a little while ago, mm-hmm. and she was talking to her doctor about feeling overwhelmed and anxiety, and the instinctual reaction was for the doctor to write a prescription. And one of the things I challenged her on was to look at the mental health aspect of it, look at the emotional health yeah. aspect of it before we take the medicine, before we take something external and add it to ourselves, whether positive or negative. Talk a little bit about the significance of maybe therapy or addressing some of the things we have inside before adding on when it comes to something externally.
Yeah, so I think that that same thing actually happened to me. So I was talking to my primary care provider about anxiety and depression, and you know, she had me do the scales and things like that. And the first thing was like, well, do you want to be on medication? I'm like, no, I don't. I don't want to be on medication for this right now. And I don't think that should ever be the first step, is to, you know, automatically give people medication rather than therapy. I think therapy has benefits in that, you know, one, you're not, you know, taking medication, or you don't have to. You can try that first, but also it just allows you a safe space to be 100% authentically yourself. And I feel like a lot of people don't get that opportunity, even when we think that we do have like these safe spaces, you know. I also think that in Black and Brown communities especially, that there is a lot of generational things that we never deal with, and so they continue to be generational issues that we pass on to our kids, and our kids pass on to their kids. And we just continue this toxic the word I'm looking for is escaping me, but just really just this toxic environment and this toxic like behavioral patterns and stuff that probably could have been at least talked about and addressed, so that people are made aware, like, this is a behavior that may have stemmed from X, Y, and Z thing that happened in your life. And so I feel like therapy helps to raise awareness of that, that people might not have, like a lot of people might not have the words to say like, oh, I'm depressed, or oh, my depression stems from school. And you know, like some people just don't have those skills. I think it's skills to, you know, work on your mental health and behavioral health, because the two I feel like are slightly different sometimes. Yeah, I feel like a lot of people just don't have those words, those terminologies to help them identify areas where they might be able to improve. Mm-hmm.
You bring up a very important word that we've touched on in a few other episodes, and that's the word trauma. We talked to some of the, you know, systemic things we have going on, as well as the, you know, societal norms which we indoctrinate within ourselves without realizing it, or take on within ourselves. One of the episodes we talked about the effects of slavery and how that sense of surviving, or that sense of demasculating and destroying the home intentionally, how that's passed down, whether we realize it or not. So when it comes to trauma, what do you recommend? What is the, if someone has a piece of paper and a pen and they say, I want to deal with my trauma, what's maybe 3 to 5 bullet points where they'll be able to address it, sit down with somebody comfortable? You know, what do you recommend given your experience?
Given my experience, I think that journaling for me has been a big thing. So journaling, not being afraid to address certain traumas or certain experiences that might be impacting the way that you behave or the way that you think about yourself or towards others, I feel like really helps, and really sitting with your thoughts. So that's something I talked to my therapist about, actually, is just sitting with your thoughts, whether they're good or not so good. And also being intentional about the things that you say, how you say it. So for me personally, like, I have a lot of like negative self-talk. And so really like thinking through things before you say things, or even if you say something and you're like, ooh, maybe I shouldn't have said it that way, saying it differently in a better way immediately after, I feel like kind of reaffirms like not speaking negatively about yourself. Just as an example. But yeah, I would definitely start with journaling. I think that is an amazing way just to get everything out there, feelings, thoughts, past experiences, and reading over it, going back and kind of reading over it and reprocessing those often, because I feel like it's a continuous cycle that we're on, learning to, you know, deal with things. So yeah, it has to be a continuous effort.
And for those who are listening with us, what is the significance of trauma? Why is it so impactful?
I think that could be different depending on what types of trauma you experience, and that could look different. Yeah, the significance of trauma. I'm trying to think of a good example or a good way to explain kind of my thoughts about that.
Okay, let's go through, if you would like to, a hypothetical situation, and we'll kind of break it down for someone who either went through or went through something similar. Let's say, here's one that I'm sure a lot are able to relate to. I grew up in a single parent household. For whatever reason, we'll just leave that to the wayside. My mother was the only one. Some of the things that I went through, and you know, I'll even talk about some of my experiences. We were left alone for long periods of time to care for ourselves. And when I would see other families, and they had the traditional structure, the natural structure of how you make a human being, I would think I was less than, or I would think that I wasn't adequate, because why do I not have these things? Why am I, I turn around and it's my brother and I, where is that the other part of me that helped me to exist? What did I do wrong? So how do you think those thoughts and those processes and those experiences, how would that shape as I'm growing and maturing and progressing? How would that either help or hurt, or whatever you have to share about the experience itself?
Yeah, I feel like, so depending on how your temperament is, I feel like that has a lot to do with like how you address traumas and how you deal with traumas. So for example, some people in that situation might come out and they might have so many like problems, you know, building relationships, trust with people because of that kind of abandonment feeling, you know. Or some people some people might not. Sorry, hang on.
Yeah, take your time. This is valuable information. I think it's worth the wait.
I forgot something like caught in my throat.
That's okay. So what I'll do is I'll take this brief pause and have a moment with the guests and the listeners. It's time we be more intentional with our conversations. When you stuff something under the rug or in the closet and push it down deep down, it's not resolving it. It's hiding it, and eventually it's gonna overwhelm you. You're giving me my opinion. So I think it's time we start having these conversations, whether it be with you, with by yourself on paper, as she recommended, whether you have somebody you trust and confide in and you have an honest conversation there, or even if you seek professional help, it's time we start addressing some of these issues, Because the way we move and the way we think and talk and speak and react to stresses and trials and tribulations, our children and the children of our community, they're watching. And they're gonna take those things on within themselves, and it's gonna manifest itself differently. And then that's gonna get passed on as well. So I challenge us, including myself, that let's be more intentional with our issues, our emotions, and our experiences, and be honest with it. Paigton, are you ready?
Yes, okay. Yes. Again, so sorry about that. but I think that I was talking about temperaments and how temperaments can affect how mm-hmm. you deal with trauma. And so I gave an example of, you know, maybe if someone doesn't have like the best temperament, I never want to use like negative terms, because sometimes not having the best temperament can also be protective of people. So I want to make sure that I'm clarifying that, like, when I say not the best, like, we're not, you know, demonizing people or making them feel less than. but on the flip side of that, I feel like if someone has kind of more positive outlook on life, you know, positive temperaments, style and stuff, they may come out of that situation like, you know what, I'm not going to be like X, Y, and Z, or I'm not going to do the things that my parents did to me, and it makes them a better parent or makes them a better person. So I just feel like it just, there's a lot of environmental factors, but also a lot of very personal factors, and I think that all ties back to really knowing yourself, or at least trying to get on a journey to knowing yourself, knowing how you react to certain things and why. I think why is a big thing that we need to start asking ourselves, and that's something that I've actually been doing myself. Like, it's not easy at all, and it's not anything that I'm perfect at, but it's something that I'm trying to be more aware of. It's like, well, why do I do this? Why do I feel like this? Why? And really just facing it head on and dealing with that in that moment.
And here's a question I ask my guests. Use the word mm-hmm. try. What does that mean?
Sorry, can you say that one more time?
I said you use the word try. What does the word try mean?
Try. And just give it a shot. Give it a go, because I feel like, you know, even giving something a shot, regardless of if it's successful or not, it's worth it, because you've done it, you've tried it, and yeah, the worst that can happen is, I don't know, you face something that maybe you can't deal with, but then you are able to go back and kind of recognize and process. Mm-hmm. I think, I don't know, just, yeah, doing things even if they make us scared or uncomfortable is sometimes a good thing when it comes to mental health.
Now, let me ask this. You are in a very, very dangerous, impactful, lucrative field. Like, what made you even get interested and stick with it?
Yeah, so I think I'll start with the community psychology, because both of them are a little different on to why I chose to like get those degrees. So community psychology, I always knew that I wanted to do something in the field of psychology, something in the field of helping people. I thought I wanted to be a therapist. I did not. or a psychiatrist. I did not want to do that. But I did still want to, you know, be able to impact lives in some type of way. And I stumbled across the field of community psychology because I was looking for places or things that would give me skills to work with youth. So I was very much interested in like juvenile justice and things like that, and like working with kids with similar backgrounds as me, and like helping them be successful, helping them, you know, change paths or whatever. And that's kind of how I found community psychology. But what community psychology gave me, surprisingly, is skills and tools to be able to empower communities themselves. So it's not like I'm coming in and being the savior of people, because that's not what people need. That's not what people want either. But if you have the skills necessary to empower them to do their own things, or, you know, be like, hey, I know how to do research, or I know how to apply for grants. Let's get something going. You know, that's more impactful than me saying, I think this community right here needs this, so I'm going to just do this, you know, because sometimes that's not what they need, or that's not their primary focus. So community psychology really allows you to do that, and that's really the focus of, well, one of the principles is really community empowerment and giving information back to people rather than coming in as an expert. And yeah, which can be problematic. But the master's in public health, so I actually have sickle cell disease. My mom had sickle cell disease. She passed from that at 22. And then my grandma has had breast cancer. Thankfully, she's in remission, and she's also had some bipolar disorder, and that kind of really pushed me towards getting a master's in public health, because I want for Black and Brown communities especially to be healthier and to have the same access to people, or the same access to resources as other people, especially if they're from. Decent care that you can feel proud of, that you can feel like your doctor has your best interest at heart. So that's really what pushed me to get into my master's in public health and focus on health equity and focus on like minority health in general. Yeah, because there's just so much that needs to be done. Like, there shouldn't be these huge disparities based on, you know, me being brown.
Yeah.
It just shouldn't exist if we're, you know, we care about people, and if people apparently, you know, all have access to the same resources, like, then why do these huge disparities exist? So, yeah, that was my main reason for getting into those fields.
You mentioned something I want to touch on. You said allowing people to do better for themselves physically. Mm-hmm. I heard you right. Give people, you know, a couple bullet points, 1, 2, 3 things that they're able to do to help themselves, both mentally, physically, emotionally. What are some words of advice you would give people?
Words of advice from a patient perspective, because I've been in and out of hospitals my entire life, and in and out of just healthcare settings, is advocate for yourself. And if you can't do that, have someone in your corner that can advocate for you, and not be afraid to be like if your doctor is trying to recommend that you take some drug for your mental health and you don't want to, being like fully free to say that, like just advocating for yourself and saying, you know, I don't think so, is there something else I can try? Because at the end of the day, healthcare providers work for you. You know, like, you're not working for them. You're not having to just take everything that they say and, you know, it's true and valid and, like, you have to do it that way. That's not the case. And there's always other options, or there's always other people that you can go to, too. I think that's another thing is don't be afraid to go to multiple people and get a second opinion. Especially when it comes to your own personal health. The next thing I think is, at the personal level, writing out your health goals, whatever they might be, and just writing those out and having those with you, I think is helpful, especially like if you go to doctor setting, then you have a list of your health goals, just being yourself aware of like, you know, this is something that I want for my health, and talking to your doctor about, hey, how can I get here? How can I do this or that? Yeah, I think those are all good ways. And just education is always a great thing. You know, knowing if your physician or provider or whoever, mental health provider, is not giving you all of the resources that you feel like you should need, just doing a quick Google search for yourself. Because although that's something that I've full on believe that like healthcare providers should be doing, sometimes they don't. because sometimes you are patient number 23 on their long day, and they only want 5 minutes with you. So, you know, sometimes you do have to go searching for yourself. With that, I will say, make sure it's a credible source. Do not go to WebMD, like, trying to, you know, self-diagnose and things like that. But I think there are practical ways to, like, search for different services or providers or things like that that you can do yourself.
And we've talked a little bit about this, and I think that was great advice. A hospital. Somebody mm-hmm. listening somewhere is going to start their own hospital. Where should they start? What would it take?
And I've thought about this question for a couple of days. I'm like, what would it take? I think that depending on the type of hospital that you want to create would depend on the type of advice that I would give. I am for free charitable hospitals and clinics. I think that those are most needed because a large majority of the U.S. are not rich. They don't have, you know, private insurance. So I think maybe starting with like a federally qualified healthcare center approach would be pretty cool, in my opinion, because there are federal dollars allocated for that, for one. So there's access to money that, I mean, you're going to need if you want to provide services and, you know, do certain tests and diagnostics and stuff like that. And if you want to provide care at a low cost to people. So I think that's one of the best ways. And then I also think that something that's missing is the connection from medical care and public health care. So public health officials are often not included in that sector. We try to bridge the gap between medical systems and public health systems. But sometimes that doesn't happen. Sometimes it does, and when it does, it's very beneficial to everyone, to the population health as a whole. So I think including public health officials would be great, and then including community voice as well, because that goes back to what I said earlier about, you know, we may think that we know what a community needs and wants, but we don't know unless we don't ask. Mm-hmm. So including their voices, because, you know, what a rural county might need compared to what an urban county might need is drastically different. Or what a brown community might need compared to a more mixed, diverse community, drastically different.
What do you think would be the biggest obstacle for the individual or group of individuals?
Competing with other hospitals and clinics, I think that would be the biggest, especially if they are for-profit entities. Because typically if they're for-profit entities, they have more access to resources, have more access to specialty services, whereas federally qualified health centers usually don't. But I will say federally qualified health centers typically are able to at least provide you with primary care, mental health, and dental care in the same facility. And I think that's something that's needed too, is, you know, holistic care in one place, because it makes it convenient for people to access services, right? If you only have to go to one place to see all of your providers, that's way better than not having to drive an hour out to see this provider and then come back and drive, you know. And then sometimes your providers don't speak to each other, but if they're all in the same space, they know your care in and out. They know, like, your mental health provider will know about your primary care or about your dental care. You know, because, again, it's all interwoven and connected. Like, you can't take care of one thing and not take care of the other. I can't take care of my mental health and not take care of my physical. I can't take care of my physical and not take care of my mental health. So, yeah.
Okay, now I'm going to put a lot of responsibility on you with this next question. A lot of influence.
Okay.
You ready?
Yes.
Okay. If you were able to change one or a few things systematically, what would it be? You know, I even give you a little bit more wiggle room with that one. Or if you were able to have people as a mass perform or stop performing a behavior, what would it be?
There's a lot of things that I would change about our healthcare system.
Okay.
Starting with free health care for everybody, regardless of financial status. And when I say free health care, I mean free access to the best quality care. Mm-hmm. I think that's the main thing. Also changing the structure of how healthcare settings are. So having streamlined services and stuff would be better, in my opinion. Letting people go to a one-stop shop type of thing, you know, where everyone, all your providers are there. I think that just streamlines the whole process. It makes it so much easier because if you think about it, people with lower incomes or people who just maybe live in rural areas, it's hard for them to take off of work, drive to an appointment, just to go to an appointment.
Yeah.
So I think if it's all in one place and they can just do everything in one day, that would be easier. Or also have hours that extend past the regular 8 to 5 business hours. There are so many people who work during that time themselves or are not able to find childcare during that time, you know, so extending hours past the traditional 8 to 5 would be beneficial. On the flip side, there are a lot of things just systemically, like why do we have $10,000 stores and liquor stores in low income areas? Like that's impacting health negatively because it's right there always, constantly, from a young age to, you know, when you're 20s, in your 20s or whatever. And so I think that, yeah, that has a detriment. But there's so many different, I could go on and on because there's so many different, like, we call them social determinants of health. And there's like 7 different areas. And so all of those areas together and separately impact health. Mm-hmm. So economics, education, your environment. So again, like liquor stores and Dollar Trees, all that. And like even your social and community context. So your ability to relate and connect with your neighbors, all of that impacts your health. So just realizing that too, I think, is a big thing. Having medical providers take public health courses to understand, like, this is real. Like, you're not just treating a person medically. Like, you shouldn't just be treating them like their physical ailments. Like, you should really be considering, well, where do they live? Well, do they have to climb stairs every day? Well, no wonder their knees hurt, you know? Things like that. So, yeah. And then your second question, can you repeat what your second question was? It was about behaviors, right?
If you would have them as a mass, either perform or stop performing a behavior, what would it be?
I think performing wise, it would just be around education because, again, I don't like to, you know, try to have some type of control or tell people that they can or can't do certain things, because I mean everything is okay in moderation, right? So I think that's probably what I would say is just do everything in moderation and pay attention to your body. I think that's an important behavioral thing. Like you have an ache, don't just let that go for days. And I do that same thing. So. But yeah, paying attention to your body is a big win.
And this one is for our middle schoolers, elementary, and high schoolers. What do they need to do to prepare for either trade or higher education? With you going through the ropes of so many different institutions, what do you recommend for them?
Talk to your school counselors. Like, don't be afraid to go in their office and be like, hey, can you direct me to or help me with looking at future career options? It's never too early. It's also never too late, though. So if you want to take that gap year for your mental health, please do. Take that gap year or 2 or 3. But I think, yeah, just talking to people and really listening to people too, because I have had the amazing opportunity to speak to a couple of like high school, middle school classes, just about my career. I think those are really great and beneficial. And I think that if, you know, you're middle school or high school, just listening and seeing like who or what people are doing, I think that is very impactful and can steer you in the right direction, and just not being afraid of asking questions. I think that's the biggest thing that has helped me, is I am a question asker. I will ask you 10 questions and like not really care if you feel some type of way about it, because I'd rather like ask the question and know the information, or either look it up on my own, but you know, I'd rather ask than not ask and be sitting there wondering, or hoping that things will go one way or the other.
Okay. And let's do this. I usually do this with my guests. In closing, what do you want the listeners and potential supporters to know about you and what you stand for, your passion? We'll even say this, your dying words, if you will.
I just hope that people know that there are passionate people out here who have their best interests at heart. And with that, I think hold us accountable. Hold professional Black and Brown people who are in spaces like healthcare and public health. Hold us accountable to listening and making sure that we're actually doing things in a way that will benefit others. Because it's easy, I think, for a lot of people to get trapped by the corporate settings, or you know, the same old, to like go into the routine of whatever their office culture is. So I would say, hold us accountable. Yeah.
And with that, we thank you for joining us on Specificity.
Yeah, I'm the boy.